in one of the most inaccessible regions of Central America, the Maya have left the remnants of an empire. They erected whole cities from stone, which climb high into the sky, a lost world of palaces, temples, and pyramids. One of the most distinguished civilizations in Latin America created an entire realm covering hundreds of kilometers, which to this day haunts the ground on which its final sanctuaries still stand. On the borders of Mexico and Guatemala, Belize, formerly British Honduras, is primarily made up of forests, caves, and rivers, a wild and impenetrable land for one of the least populated countries in the world. Some sample life out in the wild for a few days on treks deep into the forests of Belize. Without inviting trouble, you can't venture here without a guide like Marcos, whose stomping ground it has been for years. For a long time, the Maya lived in the rainforest, extracting from it food, medicine, wood, and many other things besides. It's this knowledge of the natural environment that Marshall and Natalia have come to learn from Marcus.
Now, here what we're doing is we're using the leaves, but we're not killing the plant. See, we're left behind. This right here, This is the center part of it. This is going to grow back, It regenerates. So the Maya people, they use it for roofing for their homes, for the roof of their homes.
With just his machete, Marcus can live here for several months on end, finding water in the creepers, hunting animals and insects for food, and being able to call on the countless number of plants which are known for their medicinal qualities. Scientists who are studying the forest draw on his knowledge, as do the British Army, which trains its elite troops here, and travellers who are curious to learn, among other things, how to build a shelter for the night.
For me to share that experience with other people, I find it important so that it can be educational and people can realize the importance of preserving the jungle environment, especially the Maya people who use these forests for their livelihood.
Just by burning a termite mound, it's possible to spend the night in the jungle without being disturbed too much by the nocturnal wildlife. Nearly a third of the country's forests are now protected, with 250,000 hectares of rainforest, palm trees, tropical cedars and mahogany classified as nature reserves. The tallest mountains in this country, the Maya Mountains, reach 1,200 meters in height. This environment is home to the largest natural cave system in the whole of Central America. trekking tours into the heart of this natural environment are also a good way to protect it.
Ecotourism is very important to our country. We need to sustainably use our environment so we can bring people here and we can show them it's a sustainable industry. And also it gives us the knowledge of protecting what we have because it's important.
Today, the descendants of the great Mayan Empire live in the south of Belize, in small villages. They're farmers who still live with very little and pray to Christian saints rather than their own gods. They no longer frequent their temples, which are now overgrown by the forests. Over the course of its history, the Belize of Amerindians has become the Belize of Mestizos.
All right.
Millions of slaves arrived from Jamaica and the African continent with the first Spanish and British colonizers. Today, due to their blend of ethnicity, history and culture, half the inhabitants of Belize are Creoles. They are mixed-race people of Black, Indian and European descent. The Creole community of Gales Point, Manatee, was founded by slaves in the 17th century who were fleeing a revolt in the capital, Belize City. Today, Gales Point is a small community of fishermen perched on the end of the peninsula jutting into a lagoon. People come to observe the many manatees, birds, sea turtles and iguanas which populate this remote area.
Well, this village here at Gales Point Manatee, this is a reserve. Gales Point Manatee area, our manatee reserve. And we catch a lot of stone bass in this lagoon. That's what we've been doing with the gill net. Going for the local bass.
At the tip of the peninsula, Emmeth, a master drummer, has founded a percussion school to keep the tradition of African rhythms alive. People come here from the USA, Canada, and Europe to learn to play the djembe, the congas, and the balafon.
I am from a great family, so I teach the tradition of my people through music, song, and dance. So it's my duty to teach to the youths the tradition of my people so this knowledge don't get lost. It's so the knowledge go from generation to generation. All right, let's try the samba rhythm. Play the bass.
With the modest earnings from his teaching, Emeth has set up an organization which looks after young people in his village and teaches them the rhythms and songs of their distant ancestors.
The song they are call and respond. And the roots of this music is from Nigeria. Most of the people that settled in at this area here, their roots are from the Igbo tribe.
Emeth, the master drummer, will tell you plenty more about Gale's Point. It's his dream to share his culture and history with as many people as possible and to keep traditions alive for a long time to come. The most popular attraction in this country is its zoo. Belizeans and tourists flock here to see crocodiles, jaguars, toucans, tapirs, and other native animals. For the last 25 years, parents and children alike have marveled at the animal world, thanks to Sharon, the founder of the zoo.
Come on, Mrs. B. Wow. Mrs. B.
In Belize, Sharon is one of the most passionate defenders of wildlife, and her zoo is recognized as the best small zoo in the world.
Yes, of course. Come on. What amazed me, even back then, were how many of the Belizeans, the local people, would find their way to this outpost because they heard about it. And I mean, it was remote from Belize City, the biggest city in the nation.
No problem. Have a great afternoon.
We're trying to ask people to protect the forest and that these animals are important and they don't know these animals. And what about all these children? They're growing up without the magic of animals in their life. So I just stopped my life right there and said, I don't care what it takes. I am going to turn this place into the most dynamic wildlife education center the world has ever seen.
Rocky, rocky, rocky.
Sharon is an exceptional figure who one day abandoned everything to dedicate her life to animals. In her former life, she was a US Air Force instructor, a biologist, and then an animal trainer for a circus in Mexico before she became involved in a film and found herself in charge of about 20 animals at the end of the shoot. Not being able to release them back into the wild, she built a zoo, which today accommodates more than 100 animals, all of which are native to this country, like Buddy Jr., a jaguar, which has become an icon of the zoo.
Mm-hmm. This is a sanctuary. If it weren't for the zoo, they probably wouldn't be alive. Many of them are rehab animals. They come to us very sick. They're people's discarded pets. They're born here, which is great. They're confiscated by government from people who are keeping them in illegally. Every animal has a story.
The majority of animals in this zoo are endangered species. Like the tapir, the largest mammal in Central America and one of the two national symbols of the country, along with the black orchid. Tapirs are poached and killed for their meat, as was the mother of Timbo. He's a young tapir who was orphaned and taken in by Sharon.
The future for Timbo the tapir, he's going to be a great, great symbol for habitat preservation and for saving all tapirs everywhere. Question is, do you want to live on a planet without so many dynamic, charismatic, beautiful creatures? I mean, it would be a shame to see everything go off balance if we can save what remains.
Sharon's private zoo continues its work without any public funding. If ever you come to visit this zoo, don't forget to sign your name on the wall. For $3, you'll be contributing to the protection of animals which man has all but forgotten. In the Mayan language, Belize means the way to the sea. Its islands, lagoons, and thousands of tiny islets allow you to leave the world behind. Belize has the longest coral reef on the planet after Australia. A wonder of nature which has borne witness to the shifting fortunes of the sea. Galleons on their way to new Spanish lands, vessels full of slaves, and British steamboats en route to their colony were all shipwrecked on these coral reefs. The Caribbean is a sea of adventures, but it's also the story of several islands. Long Kay's story begins with the dream of a desert island. Cut off from the world, this private island was bought in the 70s so that an eco-friendly village could be built here. Jackson, the owner of Long Kay, has been trying to develop this island over the last 40 years or so by selling plots of land to whoever is interested in buying a slice of heaven.
This is approximately a 625-acre key, 45 miles off the coast of Belize. And we're going to do approximately 300 parcels. We're almost through surveying the whole key. And 70% of it is preserved. The remaining 30% we have a minor footprint. So this is about all the construction that's going to be done out here. Just in this particular area, we have a little higher end area we're going to do right here, which we will probably put on a grid to experiment with sewage, and a solar farm and a wind farm.
The unique aspect of Jackson's eco-project is that he wants to build on this island, despite it being nothing more than a large mangrove swamp. The mangroves cover the whole of the island, support many tree species, and are a precious ecosystem for the wildlife living there. To avoid damaging this natural wonder, a raised wooden walkway of several hundred meters has been specially built. It allows access to a show home which is completely self-sufficient in terms of electricity and water supply, a house which has been built with as little impact on the environment as possible.
This is typical of what we can do. It's a minimal home. A lot more can be done as far as square footage is concerned, but this is pretty much what we're shooting for right here, and we are having very little impact, very little footprint on the key itself. The island is pretty much like it was when I was here 40 years ago. There's not a lot of difference other than we are getting access now, but I'm seeing still, after 40 years, places that I've never seen before. See plant life that just pops up, certain plants that I've never seen ever. So it's as you go, you see something more interesting every time. We don't know how they get here. Birds drop seeds. The coconuts are here. They figure that they came from Africa. They floated from Africa. A mangrove bean will come across and stick on the sand, and it'll grow. And this is all untouched. We didn't do any of this.
Jackson's Island, Long Cay, is situated on one of the most beautiful atolls in the Caribbean, Lighthouse Reef. Belize's geological wonder, the Blue Hole, is also part of this atoll. It's one of the largest marine holes in the world, 300 meters wide and 140 meters deep. The Blue Hole was originally a cave that sank below sea level over 10,000 years ago. It was made famous by Cousteau in the 70s. Today on Long Cay, around 10 plots have already been sold by Jackson, the man who makes dreams come true. It's as if Belize were a wonderful dream-making machine.
And we're living the dream now, and the dream will continue on for future generations. The important thing for us is our grandchildren will get to see what we got to see and our forefathers got to see. So I think that's the critical thing, because you can't talk about it, they have to experience it.
Belize is a distant corner of the world that keeps itself to itself. A slice of heaven on earth for those who want to veer off the beaten track and onto a pristine beach where they can let their dreams run wild. ¶¶